Bantam Doubleday Dell Audio Publishing presents Star Wars, Assault at Selonia, by Roger MacBride Allen. Hands tied behind his back, Han Solo stumbled as the guard shoved him into the gloomy audience chamber. He realized a moment too late that the floor of the central area was a half meter below the level of the entrance. Moving too fast to stop, he fell over the edge, his shoulder slammed down onto the hard stone floor. Han rolled over onto his side, then levered himself up into a sitting position. The guard stepped back out and slammed the portal shut behind them. Han was alone in the echoing gloom. He looked around, wondering what was next. At least he was out of that cell, that was something. Of course, whatever came next was not likely to be an improvement. In his experience, it was reasonably safe to be filed away in a cell. It was when you were pulled out that the trouble began. Han got himself up onto his feet and looked around. The walls and floors of the place were made of some sort of utilitarian dark gray stresscrete, and there was a dank scent to the air that suggested the windowless chamber was underground. There were four heavy steel doors, one in each side of the chamber, each of them opening out onto the perimeter platform. Anyone who stood on the platforms would be looking down at the central area. It reminded Han of a gladiator's arena, where the victim struggled for survival while providing amusement for the powers that be. The room was completely undecorated except for a not-quite-throne-like chair made of dark wood that sat on the opposite side of the perimeter platform. This was obviously where the big man of Corellia's Human League would sit, and Han had a very good idea of who the big man was going to be. His cousin, Thracken Sal-Solo. Good old murderous, scheming, vindictive, paranoid Thracken. That was the who, but what was the why? Obviously, they had been keeping him alive for this meeting, but would they have any reason to keep him alive afterwards? After all, Han had blown up half a squadron of pocket patrol boats. That was offense enough to get a fellow executed most places. Nor would his relationship to Thracken do him any good. Once Thracken had indulged his curiosity, he would be quite capable of killing Han on the spot. The doors swung fully open, and a double line of seedy-looking men in officers' uniforms came in. One column turned and marched around the corner of the platform to the left of the throne, the other to the right. By the looks of their paunchy guts, none of them had done any real training in years. Their bleary eyes, flushed faces, and unshaven jaws, and the smell of strong drink that wafted in with them, told Han that at least some of these officers had been doing some fairly serious celebrating the night before. Then Thracken Sal-Solo, one-time hidden leader of the Human League and now the self-declared diktat of the Corellian sector, came into the room. He came forward to the edge of the platform and stared long and hard at his long-lost cousin. Han stared back. He felt as if he were staring into a strange, distorting mirror. Thracken wore Han's face, or else Han wore his. Not that one could not be told from the other. Thracken's hair was darker, a black-brown shot through with gray. He was somewhat heavier, and he had a neatly trimmed beard. Thracken was perhaps 2 or 3 centimeters taller than Han. There was a ruthlessness, not just in Thracken's expression, but in the set of his face, as if that look of anger and suspicion was the one his face fell into most naturally. But even those differences did little more than emphasize how much they were alike. Han felt as if that imaginary mirror were showing him the man he might have been. He did not like that idea. "Hello, Thracken. I sort of figured I'd be seeing you."
"And hello to you, Han. Some things never change, do they? Back in the old days, you were always the one who liked to play games, and I was always the one who had to come in and clean up after you."
"That's not exactly the way I remember it." Thracken had never cleaned up after himself, let alone anyone else, but he had always been good at making it seem like he had. Most bullies were good at playing the victim. But you're right. Some things never change, Han said.
This time there's rather a lot to clean up, Thracken went on. You shot up my spaceport, damaged or destroyed 6 of my pocket patrol boats, and allowed that X-Tie ugly fighter to escape. We believe an X-Tie managed to jump into hyperspace. If its pilot gets word to the New Republic, that could throw many of my plans into disarray.
I have a suggestion, Han said. Let me go, and then let me accept your surrender. I might be able to get the New Republic to go easy on you.
I don't suppose you'd be willing to explain why I should do that.
Because you're going to lose, Thracken. Because that X-Tie got through, and even if it didn't, someone else will get the word out somehow. And you're up against the same New Republic that beat the Empire. If they could take on the Emperor and Darth Vader and Admiral Thrawn and the Death Stars, what makes you think they should have any problems with the likes of you?
Still the same old Han, full of the same old tired bluster and bluff. There's a very good reason I'm not going to lose. I've won already. The New Republic might be able to cause me some limited trouble, but nothing more. Not unless they want a few inhabited star systems vaporized. Otherwise, they will leave me strictly alone.
Han hesitated a moment before replying. Was there anything behind that claim? There was no doubt that a star had gone supernova, a star that had no business doing any such thing. The Human League had claimed responsibility, but how could a bunch of ignorant malcontents and thugs manage to blow up a star?
That was a nice parlor trick, Han said, but I'm not convinced you can repeat it. Oh, we'll convince you. Have no doubt of that.
So why am I here, Thracken? Han asked, in a tone of voice that made it sound as if he were a busy man who had more important things to do.
I did have a vague idea that you might be willing to cooperate with me, act like a patriotic Corellian, help me get rid of these New Republic interlopers. But it's not going to happen, is it?
Not in a million years.
All right, then. If you won't help me,
why should I keep you alive? Think, Han told himself. It was obvious that the Human League had deliberately timed its uprising to coincide with the trade summit, when Leia Organa Solo and lots of other off-planet movers and shakers would be on Corellia, and all of those brass were staying in the Governor General's residence, Coronet House. If the League had wanted to, it could have blown the building to smithereens, decapitating the planetary government at a stroke and killing the New Republic's chief of state as well. But they had done no such thing. Han had been at Coronet House when the assault came. In his best judgment, it had been a clumsily executed surgical strike, not a bungled decapitation attempt. It was clear that the League had intended to bottle up the Governor General and Leia and the rest of the higher-ups in Coronet House by sealing off all the exits and burying them in rubble. That Han had managed to escape was a testament to their incompetence. It was hard to avoid the notion that Thracken wanted Leia and the others as hostages. Suddenly, Han understood. His cousin was keeping him alive in hopes of using him to ensure Leia's cooperation in whatever plots he was hatching. But if he needed something from Leia, that meant Thracken Sal-Solo was not the master of all he surveyed, all bluster to the contrary. Han grinned.
There's no reason at all to keep me alive, none whatsoever. At least there isn't if you don't care how upset the Chief of State gets. And she tends to get real angry when members of her family are murdered in cold blood.
Thracken was suddenly furious.
I don't need your Chief of State.
Then why did you work so hard to capture her?
Quiet! I'll ask the questions around here. One more word about your wife, and I swear I'll kill you myself.
Han said nothing, knowing that he had won, and Thracken knew it. Han had called his bluff. Thracken kept his eyes squarely on Han as he turned to one of the officers.
Captain Falco, instruct the keepers to send the other prisoner in.
The doors swung open, and a pair of heavily armed Human League troopers came in, their blasters at the ready. They immediately took up positions on either side of the door with their backs to the wall. It would seem the Leaguers regarded the whatever it was as far more of a threat than Han. After a moment's pause, the other prisoner came in. And suddenly, Han understood all the precautions. The other prisoner...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.